And speaking about fish dying, you know, we took surface water for those trout. So when the spring floods would come, the water would get turbid and it would stress the fish and they'd get sick and they'd lose a bunch of trout. It was kind of normal at that hatchery. Mitigated as best we can. But when we go to harvest those, it's amazing how many fish sink when they die. Muskies, I don't have as much experience as you, but with trout, you know, we'd pull the water down and guys would go down there in ladders and crowd the fish into the pump to pump the fish out, and there'd be all kinds of dead ones in the corners.
Tom was just talking about, and this is something that I've realized the last couple of years from talking to other guys involved in studies. I always used to think that if you had a fish die of delayed mortality, the fish floats. You were just talking about your experience with, you were literally shocked by the number of fish that died that actually sank instead of float. So I think that from what I heard from my friend Mark Thorpe and his experience with the delayed mortality they had, he was saying that along the lines of 90% of the fish that perished later actually did sink rather than float. So is it safe to say that when we see a dead muskie floating, that's possibly just the tip of the iceberg?
Very possibly, yeah, that could very possibly. I don't know if anybody's really done any studies on that, but just your anecdotal, you know, your personal experience, you know, and other people's personal experience would indicate that's probably the case. And my experience with trout isn't the same as muskies, obviously, but fish are fish, you know, and you know, there's probably a lot of truth to that.
Yeah.
That probably is, you know, the tip of the iceberg, or at least, even if it's 50-50, that's significant, you know.
Yeah.
Even if it's half float and half sink, that's still not good.
You know?
We're still not seeing the impact that's truly happening. You know?
Right.
And if it's more than that, then it's pretty dramatic.
Now, what we've really started to talk about too is this whole trend of measuring. And as a fisheries guy now, I joke with you a couple of, you know, these guys, they want to measure everything.
I think you got to measure everything down to the quarter inch.
It's all science. But on a real serious note, what you and I've talked a lot about, that I've spoken up about, that seems to be something that a lot of people don't like you for bringing up, I found, to a certain extent, but that is the advent of more precise measurements, basically posting on social media in a lot of cases to be able to say, okay, it's exactly this long, and in a lot of cases as well, the girth. And the big factor to me is not that they want that. I don't necessarily blame someone for wanting a super accurate length. I get that, but I believe in the case that we want to get that, we should be doing it in the best way possible for the fish. And the whole idea of in boat, regardless of what it is, it could be a flexible ruler, the musky bump boards are the most popular way, but when it's in boat, it requires more time out of the water. It also creates a situation where there's a better chance than any other situation that the angler actually loses control of the fish. When I was doing it 30 years ago, it was just a wooden ruler, but I, as someone who had handled many, many fish, would actually lose control of a few myself. My clients would also have the same issue, so I stopped doing it then because of that. I realized it couldn't really be a good thing for the fish, and this is something that I would really like to encourage, is less of, if the precise measurement, what's a better way to do it? Am I right about it being a bad situation for the fish?
Yeah, and especially, you know, it again, it's anytime you do it, whether it's cold or warm, you're adding stress to the fish by doing that, and I'm a guilty thing. Not in hot water, though, I know. You know, the best way is we need to come up with, you know, there's always those floating sticks have been around a while.
I've got one right here.
You probably got one.
Yeah. And here's my little adaptation.
Oh, perfect.
So you could actually bump.
Bump it, yep.
But these work great for years. That's what I promoted after I stopped the in-boat measurement.
Yeah, anytime you can get away from, you know, less handling, that's gonna be better for the fish no matter when it is, you know. In water measuring, that'd be ideal. That's obviously the way you want to go. that fish is now, once he's in the water, his stress is going down. You know, he's still being handled, right, but he's getting oxygen at least.
Yeah. You know? Well, that's what I tell people is, you know, even if, because you have some muskies that fight you. Some cooperate perfectly. They'll lay on a bump board. They don't seem to want to wiggle or do anything. Same thing in the net. But at least if you're doing it in the water, if you have one of these feisty fish that's going wild, at least he's not flopping around on the bottom of the boat. And that's what I saw that was disappointing. Unfortunately, I still see it with the advent of the in-boat measuring. You see people that aren't real familiar with handling fish especially have more problem. And everybody's all excited, and they get their big muskie, and then they try and get that precise measurement. Next thing you hear is kaboom, 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 boom. And the fish is loose on the bottom of the boat, and that's definitely not a good thing.
Yeah, you know, that's additional abrasions that fish is getting too. You know, you're knocking that protective layer off, you know, and that's opening them up to potential incursions by pathogens, you know, like fungus, which is in practically every drop of fresh water. North America, Saprolegnum is a fungus, and a water fungus, and it can infect fish, and it's everywhere. But normally, it doesn't bother fish. Happy and good mucus layers, and they can't get at them.
They're happy, and their immune system's good. But by the way, I have to point this out. He said he's guilty of some measuring. I'm guilty of holding fish out of the water for a photo in a lot of cases as well. So I just want to make sure everybody understands. Because I don't measure fish in the boat, I say that might not be the greatest thing. Everything I do to get a picture of a fish, if it's out of the water, that's not good for the fish either. You kind of have to pick your poison, pick the situation. If it's warmer water, you got to be more careful. You got to reduce that time out of the water. I've learned to just water release fish if I feel like I'm pushing those boundaries.
Yeah.
You know, right.
One thing I've started doing, you know, I fish by myself a lot, and I troll a lot, and when I get a fish, if I want to get a picture, what I do is I have my phone, and I've got a little holder up on my dash in my little boat, and I just start the video rolling. I keep the fish in the net, get it unhooked, make sure it's happy. I get the video rolling, and then I just pick up the fish, hold it in front of the video, and then right into the water. And then I pull my still pictures off of the video. So now you're not trying to mess around with a timer, you know, and 2-3 shots. Now, and I timed myself. I got a nice little 40-incher on my chain this year, and I timed it, you know, on the how many seconds are on the video. I have a video editor. And I was able to go from the net, hold it in front of the camera, and in the water, and like, it was like 30 seconds. That fish was only out of the water like 30 seconds, and I got a good picture.
Right.
You know, you can go through those frames. You know, you can even just do a screen grab if anybody knows software at all. You can go out and get free screen grab programs, and just play your video, pause it, and do your screen grab, and that'll snap a picture of what's ever on the screen. And then there's your still shot for you know, posting somewhere. You know, if you want, and that's so much less stressful. You know, on those fish, and so that's the way I've decided how I'm, if I'm going to take a picture, that's how I'm going to do it. So that fish is out of the water 30 seconds and done. Now granted, if it thrashes and hits the floor, which can happen to any of us, you know, so it's if it's warm out, then, you know, maybe minimize that even more, you know, if we can, you know, leave it in the water.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Water release if it's really warm. And I always tell people to, with their hold for the camera, you want to be near the edge of the boat. So if you feel that fish start, you can usually tell when they're going to go.
Yeah.
Even if that's an ugly release, but that's way better for the fish to literally just throw it in the water than to try and hang on, and especially if you lose it down on the bottom of the boat.
The other thing that can happen too, if you're trying to muscle it, you know, you get a little bigger fish, you know, they're strong, and you know, you're slid up under that gill cover in that little pocket, you know. And if they thrash and you're trying to muscle it, there's a chance you could tear or break some of that cartilage and connective tissue, you know, up underneath the jaw there where the operculum, the gill cover, connects to a lot of that other stuff under there.
Right.
And scientific stuff. And
Terms I never use.
Connective stuff. And well, you know, you just you can do some damage there. You might not even realize you're doing trying to hang on.
That brings me to another point with the bigger fish. Obviously, the bigger and the heavier the fish, the more likely you might do some damage with that when they're really thrashing. This is the other problem, and we're all guilty of this. I'm guilty of it. If it's a bigger fish, what do you want? You want a little more memory, a little more, the video might go a little longer. You might want to take a few more pictures. Unfortunately, the same thing is true with the exact measurements. When somebody gets a real trophy, they want to be more exact and probably spend more time with it on that. And that's all aspects, like I say, holding for photos, whatever. But isn't that also true? These are older fish, adult fish, big, heavy fish. These are technically the ones we should handle the least, correct?
Right, yeah, because you know those big fish, you can cause even that much more stress in them. And if they're older fish, you know, you might put them over the edge, you know, if they're a real old fish. It's hard to say for sure, but you
can,
you know, you don't know how old they are, but, you know, there's, the bigger they are, the definitely, you know, I think Sean Landsman did some work. I can't remember if he associated size and stress. But I think we both know, you know, it's going to be a harder fight usually,
right?
You know, with a bigger fish,
longer fight.
You know, so they've already had, you know, that extra stress. And yeah, we all, you know, if we get a 50 plus and want to get a good shot, you know,
right?
I'm as guilty as the next guy, you know, for sure.
Oh yeah, that's human nature. You know,
yeah,
you get a big beautiful fish, you want the photos.
But I think in cold water, you know, there's a little, you know, cooler water. In the fall, there's a little more forgiveness there. But again, we really don't know for sure. You know, that's my feeling, is that there's less stress there. But I don't know for sure. And none of us know for sure at this point.
I really believe cold water's unbelievably forgiving. I tell people, and I don't know if I'm right, I can't prove it, but I tell people that if you gave me the exact same muskie, exact same fight time, exact same getting the hook out time, exact same photo time, I would feel more confident of that fish surviving 3 minutes out of the water in 40 degree water than I would with 20 seconds out of the water in 75 degree water. I would lay my odds on that 75 degree water fish dying way before the other one that was out of the water for 3 minutes.
I think that's absolutely true. There's just some common sense to that, you know.
Yeah, just the way the fish react over all the years and different conditions that I've fished in.
But I think it's important that we think about, even in cold water, we want to continue to have that in our mind. Let's minimize. You know, we also don't want to say, well, it's cold, so we can keep it out forever. You know what I mean? I think we want to always keep in our mind, let's always minimize the handling stress as much as possible, you know, even in cold weather.
I make that statement not to tell people that you should keep them out of the water for 3 minutes. You definitely
right.
should. But I believe that's the case.